sheep, blah, blah, blah. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. Eyes will be a sheep, blah, blah, blah. Eyes will be a sheep, blah, blah, blah. Eyes will be a sheep, blah, blah, blah. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. Eyes will be a sheep, blah, blah, blah. Don't want to be a goat.
This morning, if you are, have your Bibles, you're going to be looking in John for our text this morning, and John chapter 13. And in a moment when we stand, I'll ask our deacons if they would go on and make their way up to the front as we prepare for the Lord's Supper in a few moments. So if you would, if you're able to stand, I'd ask you to stand with me, please, in honor of God's Word. Begin in verse 12. This takes place during the Passover meal when the disciples had met with Jesus there to celebrate Passover, and then Jesus has told them about what's going to take place and has instituted the new Passover, as it were. And when he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place. "Do you understand what I have done for you?" he asked them. "You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set an example for you that you should do as I have done for you. I tell you the truth, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them." Let's pray. Father, truly we pray that we all just want to be sheep. Sheep who follow their shepherd day in and day out. And Father God, we will know that we have a place in your flock, each of us, and a job to fulfill. That you as the great shepherd will teach us and show us. And that as we put our hope and our faith in you, that Father God, we will follow that path and follow the trail that you have brought us to lay down upon to follow. And then, Father God, we will walk by those still waters. And we will lay down, Lord, in the fields that you have prepared for us. Father, we just ask your blessing now upon this service and all that we do. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. A little over 2,000 years ago, it was a Sunday just like we have today. Jesus entered into the city of Jerusalem on the back of a donkey. We call this Sunday Palm Sunday because as he went into the city, the people who knew he was coming went and they laid palm leaves down upon the road. They would take off their outer coats and lay them upon the road to make it a smooth ride for them. It was a sign of honor. It was a sign of praise and worship that they were offering up to Jesus. And thousands lined the streets as he went in, and they were crying out, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is he who is the King of Israel." Then on Monday morning, Jesus went to the temple. And when he got there, once more in the temple in Jerusalem, they had allowed the money changers in. They'd allowed the men with the animals and the birds all to be there to purchase temple money to bring an offering, to purchase animals to offer as sacrifice. In the place that was meant to be a place of prayer, they found themselves full of these animals and these distractions that were there. And Jesus went in and he began to turn the money changers' tables over, and he began to drive the animals from that place. Then on Tuesday, he had an encounter with the Pharisees and the priests. They tried to trap him into saying some things where they could arrest him, but they could never get that over on Jesus. On Wednesday, he gathered with those who were listening to him, and he taught them in parables. On Thursday, he gathered the disciples together to celebrate the Passover, this great Jewish celebration that they celebrated each year. And the events that we read about here in this text take place. And here in John 13, we find a clear example of what Jesus meant by having a servant's heart. You see, that's the kind of heart that I believe that Jesus had. It's the kind of heart that he desires for us to have and for us to exhibit to the world. Now, what kind of heart is that? What kind of heart is that? Do we have, as our title says, the kind of servant heart that Jesus wants me to have? Now, what do the servant hearts look like? Well, a servant's heart is a humble heart. A servant's heart is a humble heart. Look at what it says in the first verse there in this chapter. It was just before the Passover festival, and Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. And the evening meal was in progress, this Passover meal, and the devil had already prompted Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. Now let's think about what Jesus knew in this moment. What did Jesus know in this moment that's about to take place? He knew, as the scripture says, that his hour had come. He knew that his time of ministry on earth was now about to be over. He knew the cross was awaiting him. He knew that death was awaiting him. He knew his hour had come that he would depart from this world. He also, as the passage tells us, knew that Judas was going to betray him. The devil having already entered into the heart of Judas to betray him. Now, think about how you would have felt if you'd been Jesus. Would there have been anger, bitterness, resentfulness? But we don't see that in him. Instead, we see that he treated Judas with the same love that he did the other 11 disciples. Even as they ate, it says that he dipped the sop, he took the bread, dipped it in some sauce that was there for the meal, and he handed it to Judas. In their culture, that was a sign of great love. It was a sign of honor that the host would himself personally dip this in the sauce and give it to you. Now, how would we have responded to Judas? Well, look at how we respond to folks today who make us mad. How do we respond when folks betray us or hurt us? And yet Jesus teaches us that we are to love them and to forgive them. Jesus also knew that the Father had given all things to him to prepare him for what was about to take place. Verse 3 says, Jesus knew the Father had put all things under his power and that he had come from God and was going to return to God. Now we know what he knew, but look what he did when he knew these things. Verse 4 and 5, he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him. At the very moment of his greatest glory, now for us, we can't comprehend that a cross, crucifixion, would be glorious. But for Jesus, it was a glorious moment because he was about to accomplish the will of his Father. He was about to make the ultimate sacrifice for mankind to once and for all pay for all the sin that we have committed or will ever commit. He was about to enter into this most horrible time of suffering. But also it was the most honorable time for when he went back into heaven, there would be such honor and glory given to him. And in the midst of all this that's going on in his mind of what's about to take place, Jesus humbles himself to serve his servants. 2 Corinthians 8, 9 puts it this way, for you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, Christ was rich, for our sakes, he became poor, that we, through his poverty, might become rich. He let go of everything that he had, all the power of heaven, all the riches of heaven. He laid those aside so that he might come and raise us up, that he might make us rich and wonderful, filled with the spiritual things that God had for us, and a heavenly home that will be beyond our comprehension. Now, why did Jesus wash their feet? Did he think, as they were sitting there eating, you know, the Passover, did he keep going, somebody got some stinky feet in this place? Any of y'all know people that somebody has stinky feet? Yeah, thank you, sis. I appreciate that. And you know, I've told most of you the story. Let me just tell you real quick. First time I brought Patty home to meet my family, I thought it was going to be a glorious thing. I took my shoes off and my sister went to the bathroom, got a can of Lysol and came back and sprayed my feet right in front of her. Anyway.
Humiliating.
Yeah, humiliating. That's forgot you, right?
Yes.
But Jesus looked at his disciples. I mean, this was a job that a servant did. And you know the culture of that day, whenever you went to someone's home to eat, usually there would be a servant or someone there who would greet you at the door, and as you took your sandals off, they would wash your feet because of all the dirt and dust that were there just to kind of soothe you and to make you comfortable. No one had done that this night. And so Jesus stops and he wants them to learn a lesson about servanthood. Now why? Because they struggled, these guys did. In Luke's gospel, it tells us this, Luke 22:24, that as they were traveling, right before this happened, a dispute arose among them as to which of them was considered to be the greatest. They are following the greatest man who had ever lived, yet they're fighting over which of them is the greatest. And it happens still. It happens in churches. It happens among church members and pastors and deacons and about among other churches. You get this competitive spirit. You know, you want to be the top. You want to be the greatest. You want to be the best. You want to be the one who's always right. You know, we've all met people over the years who they're really happy as long as things go their way. But if they don't, then they get real disgruntled. I remember one church I was in years ago some of the folks didn't like what the pastor had done, the programs he was instituting. So they said, well, we'll just hold our money back. And whenever they change and do what we want, then we'll give our money. That's not how Jesus establishes and wants us to be. But we still need to learn the lessons of servanthood. We need to understand what it is to be a servant. So to develop a servant heart, we must develop a humble heart. I love this quote. I don't know who first said it, but I've seen it for years. It says, humility is not thinking bad about yourself. It's just not thinking about yourself at all. It's not just thinking, oh, I'm a worm, I'm terrible, I'm horrible, you know, and no good. No, it's just that you are not the main focus of your life. Listen to how Paul described it in Philippians 2. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourself. Not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. And then he goes on to describe how Christ came from the glory of heaven, humbled himself, became a man, and then humbled himself all the way to the point of death. And so first we see that a servant's heart, the kind of heart Jesus wants us to have, is a humble heart. Secondly, it's a clean heart. In verse 5. After that, he poured water into the basin and began to wash their feet. And he came to Simon Peter, who said to him, Lord, are you going to wash my feet? You know, you can see old Peter drawing back, pulling his feet up under him, crossing his legs, however he ever did it. But he didn't want Jesus touching his feet. Jesus replied, you don't realize now what I'm doing. But later you will understand. No, said Peter, you will never wash my feet. Remember, Peter was the one we studied earlier when Jesus had done something marvelous there and got their nets full of fish. You know, he said, depart from me, Lord, I am a sinful man. Peter just didn't see himself as someone worthy for Jesus to wash his feet. Then the Lord said, Jesus answered, unless I wash you, you have no part with me. Then Lord Simon Peter replied, not just my feet, but my hands and my head as well. And Jesus answered, those who have had a bath need only to wash their feet, for their whole body is clean. And you are clean, though not every one of you. For he knew who was going to betray him. And that was why he said, not every one of you was clean. Now Peter is horrified. Lord, I just can't allow you to do this. And then Jesus explained to him, Peter, those who have been washed completely, this indicates the act of salvation. He says in verse 10, who have had a bath. Now, we understand that, you know, that to have a bath spiritually is a one-time thing. You don't need to have multiple baths spiritually. Physically, probably a good idea to have more than one. Mm. Of course, I remember one little fella at Camp Schaefer who, on Thursday night when his mother and father came, found his soap box still sealed up and his towels dry. And asked him why, and he said, well, I swam every day. I didn't need to take a bath. We won't mention Mark Rowe or like that. Anyway, but we need a bath. You know, we need a bath every day, but spiritually, the bath that Jesus talks about, being washed in his blood, being saved, being born again, that's a one-time thing that happens to us. And when we have it forever. And so when he says you wash in verse 10, it's a one-time thing. But then the other times he talks about washing, is washing their feet that they would have a holy walk. When our sin is confessed, we have an unbroken fellowship with God. But we all know that whenever we sin, whenever we get to a place, you know, where we're in our Christian life and we're doing something that we shouldn't do, and we know it and we feel guilty about it, we go to God and we pray, Lord, I know I shouldn't have done this, and I'm sorry. And we sense immediately that cleansing that he gives. And that's what he says here. Living in this sinful world, at times we get dirty. And we need to have our feet washed. 1 John 1:9 puts it like this. If we confess our sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us of all our sin. And he wants to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Jesus said, there are just times that you need to come back and confess some things because it hinders your relationship with God. Once we're saved forever. Nobody can take it away from us. We are God's child and will be for all of eternity. But even in our walk as a Christian, we sometimes blow it, we sometimes fail, and we need to go back and say, God, I'm sorry. I knew better than to say that. I knew better than to do that. I knew better than to think that or want that. And God, it's affected my fellowship with you. We all understand strains in our relationships, whether it's with family members or friends or co-workers. Something happens between you, you kind of have a little out, you know. And so you don't talk like you used to. You don't do the things you used to do. And until you get it straightened out, it's kind of an uncomfortable feeling. That's how we are with God. Whenever we sin, we kind of get an uncomfortable feeling within us that we're not where we ought to be. And so we need to get cleansed. And he says if we confess our sin, God is ready and willing to forgive us. So once Peter understood that, he said, Lord, then not just my feet, but my hands and my head as well. Jesus, don't just wash my feet, but wash all of me. And again, Jesus said, well, Peter, you're clean. You don't need to be washed all over. But notice something else. The feet of Jesus, Judas, were also washed by Jesus. Jesus said to them, you are clean, but not all of you are clean. Verse 11. For he knew who was going to betray him. And that was why he said, not everyone was clean. So he knew. Even as he shared with them about this cleansing, as a servant to have a clean heart, to be saved, to be born again, he knew that even then, one of them had not experienced that kind of faith. One of them had not come to believe in him fully as the Messiah. So a servant's heart is humble, a servant's heart is clean. And then lastly, he shows us that a servant's heart is joyful. When he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place. You understand what I have done for you, he asked them. You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. Very truly I tell you, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. And now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. He said to the disciples, do you understand? Do you understand what I've done? It wasn't just a matter of just getting your dirty feet clean. It wasn't a matter just of soothing, you know, your hot, tired feet. You see, the lost world seems to think that true happiness is being served by others. The more I can get people to do for me and the less I have to do, the better it is. But as a Christian, we are to understand that real happiness comes from being able to serve and to minister to others in the name of Christ. Last Sunday, we went out with Patty's mom and her sister and brother and niece. And we went to the restaurant. The waitress came up and took our order. And I said, ma'am, I said, we're getting ready to pray. I said, is there anything you'd like for us to pray for you about? And she kind of looked at me funny for a moment. I said, well, yeah, there is. And she began to share some things and said, just pray for me too, because I got a lot of stuff going on. And so when we prayed, we prayed for her and asked God to bless her. And later on, she came back by and I said, I just want you to know, we've prayed for you today. And she patted me and said, well, thank you so much. You know, that made my whole day. Just to know that just a small little thing that we could do, just to pray for this lady, would bless her like it did. Real happiness comes when you learn that serving and ministering to others in the name of Christ, not so you get patted on the back, not so that somebody will put your face on a plaque on a wall somewhere, but because you want to do it in the name of Jesus, that he will be glorified. Jesus went on to say, verse 17, you will be blessed, you will be happy, joyful, if you do that. If you do these things, if you learn to be a servant to those around you, your family, your friends, your co-workers, fellow students, whatever it may be, you will be blessed if you do it. Dr. Warren Wiersbe, in his commentary, said, Jesus did not come to lower himself to our level, but to raise us up to his. He came and lived among us where we are, that he might bring us up to live the life that is more abundant that he promised. Dr. C.K. Chesterton wrote that a truly great man is one who makes others feel great. Again, going along with what we said a moment ago, what Jesus said, you'll be blessed if you do these things. See, knowing these things and understanding them is only half of the responsibility. We are also required to do them. James 1:22 says, you are to be doers of the word and not ones who hear it only. Don't just hear what the preacher says. Don't just hear and understand what the Bible says. But do it. Do it. Be humble. Be clean. Be full of his joy. And you will begin to develop a servant heart that Jesus wants you to have. In a moment, we're going to be celebrating the Lord's Supper. And in doing so, we are honoring and worshiping the greatest servant of all time. There's never been anybody who was more of a servant than Jesus. He served God. He served his fellow man. He served us by serving up his life on the cross to pay for our sin. We are celebrating his great sacrifice for us in giving up his body and his blood for us, in taking our sin, my sin and yours, and the punishment that was associated with, connected to that sin, upon himself, that you and I might be saved, redeemed, forgiven, and be made right with God. So as we prepare to take it, we ask ourselves, am I the kind of servant that Jesus would have me to be? Am I? Are you? Is my heart humble? Is it clean? Is it full of his joy? Am I living the life he desires me to live? Am I being a servant to others? Have I accepted his payment for my sin by admitting that I'm a sinner, believing that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, came and died on the cross to pay for my sin, was buried and rose again the third day? Have I committed myself to him and declared that faith to the world? If not, today, would you do that? Would you let him save you? Would you let him come into your heart and life and make you whole like you have never been before? Father God, we pray that even now you would remind us of all that your Son has done for us in giving his life, in humbling himself to come and live among us as he did, to bring us new life, new hope, and an eternal future with you in the glory of heaven. Father, my first prayer is today that if there's somebody here who's never experienced that, that right now, this moment, your Spirit would convict their heart. You would make them realize their need of Jesus. Convict them of their sin and of the fact that there is only one way for that sin to be relieved from them, and that's through Jesus. And Father, for those of us who have made that decision, help us to ask ourselves that question, am I the kind of servant that Jesus desires me to be, that he has prepared me to be? Am I doing those things? Am I humble? Do I desire to be clean, confessing my sin daily? And Father God, am I willing to be filled with your joy that others may, Father God, come to know you through the life that I live and the words that I speak? Help us each one, Lord, to examine our hearts today. And if there's things that we need to get corrected, help us, Lord, to do that today, whether it's at our seat or at the altar, or Lord, just come in and asking for prayer. Help us, Lord, to get those things made right with you today. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Our invitation hymn is 596, I Surrender All. As we stand and sing, if God is speaking to your heart today, you need to surrender to Him. Do it as we sing.